So first of all, welcome. Very good evening to all of you. So as Sir discussed that my topic is on the server optimization part. So how we can optimize our Magento server so that it can give us more and more efficient result and it reduces our load time. So as I mentioned, my name is Nitin. I'm working as IT security engineer in Webpool from past 2 years. So let's start the topic. Okay, so now the first question is why optimization is so important. See, the thing is, first is user experience, because if user experience is not up to the mark, if users don't want to browse your website just because of this server bottleneck and all these things, so it really reduces your say, it really reduces your you can say resources and all. So that's why user experience is very, very important. Next thing is handle traffic. Obviously, if your server is not up to the mark to handle the bulk of the traffic, so how you manage to run your application with efficiency and with better result? Third thing is improve your sales. As per the Amazon, what they said, if you increase your load time up to 1 second, then it will directly increase your sale up to 10%. So I think so. If you can decrease your website loading time around 1 or 2 seconds, it will boost your sale around 10 to 20%. So why don't we go for the optimization if we have such kind of positive results? Fourth thing is increase SEO. See, as per Google, what they actually they haven't mentioned this thing, because all of you know that their algorithms are totally you can say not publicly available, what exactly they use to rank the SEO part. So according to them, in their blog thread, they mentioned, if your website is fast as compared to your competitors, then it will surely increase your SEO ranking as compared to them. For example, there are two sites, site A and site B. Both are selling the same good. But if website A takes around 10 seconds and another website B is taking around 2 or 4 seconds, then surely on the search result, it will rank above. So that's why we have to use such kind of best practices to optimize our server for better results. Now, what are the root causes of speed or load time issues? First thing is, browser cache is not ready. I think most of you know that all the static contents like JS, CSS, HTML, our browser can cache all this content in itself, so that whenever you request again and again, it doesn't go for the static content again to the server. It just caches all the static content within itself. Second thing is, application code is not optimized. As my friend already discussed, that what application optimization practices we have to follow to speed up our website. Third thing, which is most common, server resources are not enough. Because most of the time, developers say that I think CPU usage is increasing, or maybe RAM is not up to the mark. That's the bottleneck. So yeah, server resources is also a very important part if we have to look for the speed or load time issues. The fifth thing is no application caching. Maybe you haven't applied any kind of application caching mechanism. I don't know how many of you know about the Varnish cache, the Nginx, all these things. We can use such type of mechanism to boost our application caching and all these things. The fourth point, which is limited network bandwidth. See, network bandwidth is also an important thing. For example, if we have two servers, one has around 100 Mbps of Ethernet connection, another one has around 1 Gbps of Ethernet connection, then surely the server which has a 1 Gbps Ethernet connection will serve the more content as compared to the server which has a 100 Mbps. So network bandwidth is an also important part. Okay, now let's talk about how we can overcome these issues like resources, or the part of resources, bandwidth and caching. So we can integrate our Magento with these three things. Actually, we can integrate Magento with various other things as well, but as we have very limited time, so I just want to discuss about these three things: CDN, AWS S3, and reverse proxy. Because these three things, we even as a developer community, we can use these technologies with our middleware. So now the question is, what is CDN? Actually, it's a network of reverse proxy servers which are located globally, distributed globally. It provides you the high availability. How? See, let's take an example. You purchase a CDN from, let's take an example of CloudFront, or you can say about the Cloudflare. Okay, let's take an example. They have around 50 reverse proxy servers all over the globe. And now, due to some network issue or due to some any other reason, their 3 or 4 servers will go down. So what will happen? They have around 45 to 46 servers. They still have 45 to 46 proxy servers with them, which can serve the static content. I just want to point one more thing. What exactly CDN does? It just caches the static content. Okay. For example, CSS, JS, HTML, images, all these things. So, what exactly reverse proxy server does? It just caches the static content. So, the static content will be served from any reverse proxy server. So, we can, by performing this, we even can reduce the load on the main server, because all the static content will be served by the CDN, and all the part which is executable, like just PHP and all these things, will be served from the main server. Now, this is just an example how exactly CDN works. As you can see in the middle, it's a main server. And all the small servers are kind of, you can say, proxy servers. So now let's take an example. As you can see, our main server is in the Europe region. Let's take an example. And all the proxy servers are located all over the region. If our user is from the US, so if we want to access our website, what exactly happens? All the static content, images, JS, CSS, all these things will be served from this server, this proxy server, not from the main server. Only the PHP files, they will be served from the main server. So what exactly we have done? We just reduce the load time, we just reduce the load average on our server. So this is how the CDN exactly works. Any question from this diagram? So now, let's start how we can implement the AWS CDN CloudFront in Magento. Okay, because it's very easy. Anyone can integrate CDN with Magento or any other platform. Even for the Magento, we have various kind of plugins available. So, okay, now before going to this slide, I just want to give you just brief how exactly we can create a CDN. See, on the AWS, when you create a CDN, what exactly AWS does, it just clones your whole website to a different URL, to a different proxy server. So it provides you a URL. For example, let it be your website is abc.com. So what AWS does, it just creates a random URL. Maybe it's abcxyz.cloudfront.com. So you have that URL, which is a total clone of your website. Now what you can do, you have to pass the base URL for static view files, which is in the Magento 2 is CloudFront, the URL of the CloudFront, for example abc.xyz.cloudfront.com, which is the URL of your CDN, /pub/static. So now all the static files will be served from that URL, not from your main server. Same will happen with the base URL for user media file. In the user media file, you have to mention the URL, the CloudFront URL /pub/media. Now all of your media files will be served from the CDN. As I mentioned that your CDN URL is the totally clone of your main server. So whenever you upload a new file or whatever media you want to upload later, it will directly be cloned with the CloudFront app. Okay, proof. Actually, nowadays even Indian Army is facing the same thing. So everyone is looking for the proof. So yeah, I'm also prepared for that. Here's the proof. As you can see, actually I just than the UR, because I don't want जो हमारा क्लाइंट है उसके ऊपर भी इतने ज़्यादा टेस्टिंग वगैरह हो कि उसकी साइट कितनी फास्ट है, that's why I just blurred the UR. So here we can see in the details this site is loaded in 3 seconds, just 3 seconds. And this is a screenshot of the web page test tool. It's a very very common tool to test your website load time and all this. In the next slide, as you can see, when we go to that website, all the static content like CSS, JS, images, your all of the static content which are from the CDN part, not from the main server. So this is the benefit of using the CDN with your website, with your Magento or any of the framework you really want to do. Okay, now let's talk about the S3. This is again another AWS service, which is S3. Actually, S3 is a simple storage service which provides you a centralized storage so that you can store all of your data in a centralized storage. And actually, it just makes web scaling computing easier for developers. It provides you unlimited storage, so you don't need to be scared for the limited parts. For example, nowadays, if you talk about the EC2 server, EC2 is a kind of AWS server thing. So maybe if you have a server which has only 40 GB of hard drive, so you don't need to be that worry about in the part of S3, because S3 stores unlimited storage. You can store unlimited data how much you really want. They just charge you up to the space, how much space you are using on the AWS S3. And as I already mentioned, it is centralized storage. You can store all your data within a centralized bucket, because in the S3, what exactly AWS does, it creates a bucket for you and you can store as much as data you want. And on a single account, I hope they provide around 50 buckets. So as you can see, you have 50 buckets and unlimited storage to use. Now, this is highly scalable, reliable and fast and inexpensive data storage. Because to be honest with you, if you compare this service with the competitors, it will be very very inexpensive. So I don't think so why we can't use such type of technologies with our Magento and all. Now this is an example of how S3 exactly works. Okay, first of all, tell me how many of you know about the load balancer. What exactly load balancer does? Anyone knows what about exactly load balancer is? Okay, no problem. Actually, what exactly load balancer does, whenever a request comes to load balancer, it will redirect it to the server. See, let's take an example. Right now, your server has only around 100 or 200 concurrent users. But after 4 or 6 months, it will increase up to 1000 or 2000. Then what will do? Maybe you just increase the resources of your present server. Or what you can do, you just create the horizontal scaling. What exactly horizontal scaling is? You can increase the servers as per the traffic. So in this architecture, your load balancer is the main thing which will be handling the request and response. Whenever a user requests to the website, it just goes to the left load balancer. Load balancer will request the server as per the traffic of which server is right now idle, or it's up to their algorithm. So they will, load balancer will balance all the traffic on the servers, and we have a S3 bucket as a centralized storage. See, I'll give you an example why centralized storage is important in such kind of architecture. See, let's take an example. When you have set up such type of architecture, everything works fine because all those three servers are clone of each other. But after, let's take an example, if you have to upload a new product on your store, then all the images, okay, the product information will go to the database, but what about the images? Where you can store the images? If you store on the server one, then if a user requests the load balancer and load balancer routed to the server two, how you get the images? So that's why we need the centralized storage for such kind of architecture. So all the images, all the static part will be stored in the S3 bucket, and this architecture will work smoothly as much as you can. Any question on this architecture? till now?
Okay, great.
Now, the benefits of using S3. You can create your store data in buckets, as I already mentioned. You can create a bucket in your AWS account on S3 service. You can download or upload data in a fly. See, you don't need to go to the server to download or upload, because all the data is served on the bucket. And the thing is, if you have to download the bucket, the AWS will provide you the URL. For example, something like abc.s3.aws.com. So you have a URL to upload or download the content. Even they will provide you the standard interfaces, the APIs like SOAP, REST and all. So you can communicate with the S3 bucket with the help of these APIs. The most important thing is the permissions. You can set up the permissions as per your need. If you want all the materials to be public, you can set the permission public and anyone can download the content without any issues. But if you want to set a permission on something, on the specific permissions, then you can. So this is the beauty of the S3, that you have to use for the centralized storage. Now, the next thing which I mentioned in my previous slide, reverse proxy. Okay, first of all, tell me, how many of you knows about the reverse proxy? What exactly reverse proxy is? Okay, I think all of you are aware about the proxy. College time you want to know that. So proxy ka to I guess idea tha. So what exactly reverse proxy is? See, it's a very minute difference in the forward proxy and the reverse proxy. When we use proxy on the client end part, for example, when we use in our local architecture, for example, as a firewall, as a proxy, then it works as a forward proxy because it knows how many client resources it has. But when we use the proxy for the server part, then it will work as a reverse proxy, because at that time we know how many servers we have at backend, but doesn't know how many clients are requesting for that. So this is the example of reverse proxy. So what exactly reverse proxy does? Retrieve resources on behalf of a client from one or more servers. These resources are then returned to the client as if they originated from the proxy server itself. Now you can use the proxy server as a firewall to prevent attacks such as DOS or DDoS. I hope DOS or DDoS, these two terms are not alien for you. Are you guys aware about DOS or DDoS? Okay, I tell you. DOS is a denial of service, and DDoS is a distributed denial of service. Actually, this is the most common attack nowadays on the server. Because what exactly happens with DOS attack? For example, let's take example of a single server. For example, if your server is around 100 Mbps, but people from all over the world, or you can say from the hacker network, they are trying to access your resources with much of the bandwidth. For example, your server has a bandwidth of around 100 Mbps, but you are getting requests around 300 or 400 Mbps. Then what exactly your server does? It can't do nothing. It fails to respond on that part, because it's up to its limit. So that's why you can use it as a firewall. It's a very good example of reverse proxy as a firewall is Cloudflare. Cloudflare used as a reverse proxy as a firewall. Now we can reduce load on its origin server by caching static content, as I already mentioned. It worked as a load balancer and SSL termination. Now, thing is, what is SSL termination? See, let's take an example of various caching applications. For example, let's take a Varnish. Okay, so Varnish is only compatible with the HTTP request, but not with the HTTPS. So it doesn't have a support of SSL. So what we can do, we just set up a reverse proxy ahead of the Varnish. So what exactly does? SSL is terminated with the help of reverse proxy, and caching will be done with the help of Varnish. So this is the very you can say important part of reverse proxy, that we can do such kind of thing with the help of reverse proxy. Now, as I already mentioned in the part Varnish is a HTTP accelerator. It accelerate your HTTP request and response part. It provides you full page caching. For example, in your Magento store, if you have a product, so the product URL will be just will look like something.html. So what exactly it does, it just caches the whole static page. So if a person again requests for the same product or for the same URL, it just caches the it just serves from the caching, not from by executing command again and again. You can use Varnish as a load balancer, but to be honest with you, for load balancing part, Nginx is much better than it. It just supports HTTP. You can customize it with the help of VCL, Varnish configuration language. Put, post, delete requests are not cached. I don't think so. I have to explain why put, post, delete requests are not cached. Cache management and purging. You can purge the cache on Varnish very easily, which is not available with the Nginx or any other cache management. Now let's talk about how to configure Varnish with Magento. It's a very simple thing. See, this is the admin panel of your Magento, and on the system you have to select the Varnish caching, and in the access list you have to provide the IP from where you can purge the cache. In the backend host you have to mention the IP of the server. It might be Apache, Nginx or IIS, whatever you are using. So you have to mention the IP of that backend server. In the backend port, you have to mention the port on which your backend server is working. And in the next part, you can export the VCL, that's the file, for Varnish 3 as well as for the Varnish 4. So after you export the VCL file, you can store it in the WHERE part, in your Magento WHERE part. From there, it works as a caching mechanism. Then it's time to do the findings. As you can see, we have a demo website, which is magento19testing.webflow.com. This is the data without Varnish. As you can see, the website is taking around 5.845 seconds to load. Now, when we have enabled the Varnish, how exactly it works? We just loaded it in 2.484 seconds. So as you can see, you can reduce the load time twice. So I think it's a very important tool, Varnish, because it doesn't require that much of knowledge about the server thing and all. You just have to use the Varnish on the or you have to enable the Varnish on the admin panel, and you can go with that. Now Nginx. Nginx is also you can also use it as a reverse proxy, but to be honest with you, for the caching part, Varnish is much better than Nginx. But if you have to provide the static content, then Nginx if you have to provide the static content, then Nginx is better as compared to Varnish. So what exactly we can do, as I have done in my various server architecture, we just set up the Nginx in the front in the front part as a reverse proxy. After that we set up the Varnish. Behind the Varnish we have Apache or Nginx. Apache server is running as a backend server. So we will serve all the static content from the Nginx, caching mechanism from the Varnish, and all our execution from the Apache. So this is kind of architecture we can go with to increase your optimization, to decrease your load time at all. So that, as I already mentioned, we can use Varnish and Nginx as a reverse proxy. Now it's up to you what kind of architecture you want to go with your Magento. So it's totally on you. Both the things do the same thing, but there is a minor difference. You can use Nginx as a backend server, but not Varnish, because Varnish doesn't execute the PHP file. With the help of Nginx, using PHP FPM, you can execute PHP files. And same with the Apache, you can with the help of mod PHP. But that thing is not available with the Varnish. So it's totally up to you what type of architecture you really want to go with your Magento. Thank you.